Hello, you wonderful people, and welcome to another episode of Not Too Comic Book. This being a show where I talk about TV shows that are adaptations of comic books. For today's episode, I'm going to talk about the latest episode of The Flash, as well as Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Starting off with The Flash, in this episode, you know, Barry's still without his powers, and it comes down to the decision of what's Barry going to do. The fact is, Wells is telling him there's a way to get his powers back to basically recreate the particle accelerator explosion, but Barry's kind of like not 100% set on it, because it's like, the fact is, the particle accelerator, when it originally exploded, like ruined a lot of people's lives. You know, there was a benefit for him because he was able to become a superhero. He was able to protect the city. You know, a lot of bad people got powers too. So, and interestingly enough, you end up finding out that something that's never really been brought up ever, at least I don't think so, not to my recollection. But you know, I am stupid. And I do end up forgetting things from time to time. But in Earth 2, apparently, the particle acceleration was, like, kept specifically to the central city, and it didn't spread out anywhere, so the metahumans are only located there. But apparently here on Earth 1, apparently there's metahumans widespread across the world, apparently. Like, when the particle accelerator exploded, it just hit central city, it hit everywhere. The reason why there haven't been any, like, you know, but it hasn't, the reason why there haven't been many reports is because what they're saying is that the metahumans have kind of kept themselves hidden away because the Flash, they heard about the Flash, so it's kind of like, oh, there's already one of us out there collecting, you know, taking down other metahumans, so we better not really go off doing it, especially one that's that fast that could come track us down at any point in time. It's what I can only assume. That's kind of what the picture they paint, but it's kind of like the world is a very big place. It's like, I feel like they didn't necessarily have to create that scale of like, oh, there's metahumans everywhere. We're only seeing the ones that kind of find themselves in Central City. It's kind of like, you know, it's okay for a superhero to only deal with problems in their specific city. It's just like Batman. You know, it's okay for Batman just to deal with problems in Gotham and not have to necessarily worry about everything in Metropolis or what's going on out there in the universe, you know, out there in space. I mean, granted, yes, you can break it down and be like, oh, except for when Batman's in Metropolis or when the Batman's in the Justice League Tower in space keeping an eye on everything. I know, technically, but it's like, you know, it's okay to keep it compact to Central City, but I guess it's like to give you the opportunity to be like, there's actually much more to it. There is a grander scale to this whole metahuman thing you've just never seen. It's interesting to think about, but it's like, it's not something they necessarily had to include, but it's cool that they did. And an interesting thing they brought up this episode was a hologram Flash. That they basically, how they kept basic criminals at bay. They essentially were using, like, basically hooked Barry up to a machine, was creating hologram Flash to kind of keep people preoccupied. It was very interesting because it's like, I don't think they've never handled a situation of Barry not having powers like this before. It was a very, like, interesting way. Granted, they were kind of, like, not sure if it was necessarily going to work. I mean, obviously, you can still tell there's some kinks in the program because it's, like, it kind of phases in and out and kind of you can see it glitching a little bit. But I guess, you know, people would, like, you know, any normal person would kind of chalk that up to being like, oh, the reason why he's like that is because it's actually, you know, because the Flash is very fast. He's vibrating and moving so fast that that's why he looks all glitchy like that. I don't know. Or maybe, you know, the glitchiness is there for us. Maybe if you want to get technical with it, the people he's going up against don't actually see it. It's just he, like, you know, we as the audience get to see it, but technically who he's going up against doesn't see it, maybe, like I said. But multiple things I really liked in this episode. One was the decision, like, because it came down to what Barry, like, it was like, okay, Barry, what are you going to do? Basically, he legitimately had, like, the three influential males in his life kind of being there, all with different points of view. You have his dad, Henry, there, who, side note, real quickly, since it's right there in the top, like, the top of my brain, you end up finding out his mom's maiden name is Garrick. So it's like, because he brought up the fact that, yeah, Jay, Garrick, he's like, Garrick? He's like, huh, my mom's maiden name is Garrick. It's like, okay, like I said, it's been fully established. Obviously, the man in the mask is Jay Garrick, but now I get this, now we get to see, like, now we can see that Earth 2 Jay Garrick is, whether he's Barry's dad in Earth 2 or not, he might not be. Barry might have a completely different dad in Earth 2, but, you know, Henry is Jay Garrick. You know, his doppelganger in Earth 2 is Jay Garrick. It's the only way I can only assume, with him having the last name Garrick like that. So, very interesting. It'd be kind of cool, like, because I think they brought that up before, too. I think that's come up before, because some people are like, oh, it'd be cool because he played, the actor who plays Barry's dad, Henry, he played the Flash in, like, the 90s TV show. So it'd be kind of interesting if he was the Flash. Because some people were like, oh, what if he became the Flash and he was like, oh, yeah, like, Barry ended up going to another dimension where he met his dad as the Flash. But it's like, in this, it's like, to me, they're setting it up to make it so it's like, oh, yeah, the big reveal is that's who Jay Garrick is. Because I was always, like, because I was still mainly under the impression that Jay Garrick would look like Hunter Zolomon, but now it's kind of like, you know, but then I did throw out the possibility that he might also look different too. So I guess that's the main reason why he kind of hid his identity, because it's like, Barry would have instantly been like, dad, and it just, maybe that's one reason, I don't know. Because that is something, because like, when Barry went to Earth 2, that is something that came up, his mom, never his dad. He, you know, he talked to his mom for, I mean, Earth 1 Barry, when he would replace Earth 2 Barry on Earth 2, he would talk to his mom. He never actually talked to his dad, so we don't actually know what the situation is. So like I said, probably in that situation, either his dad is still like Henry, but I mean, obviously on Earth 2, he's Jay Garrick, that, or they, like, he has a completely different dad on Earth 2. Just something to throw out there. But what I really want to focus on, the fact is you have those three different, you know, going back, those three influential males there telling what, you know, what he should do. You have Henry, his dad, his biological dad, telling him, you know, not to do this, that, you know, basically he doesn't need to be a superhero to be a hero, you know. And then you have Joe, who's actually undecided. He's like, he doesn't know what's right and what's wrong. He's like, the city needs to Flash, but he doesn't want to put Barry in any danger because he cares about. And you have Wells, who, like, this isn't necessarily the Wells that Barry has come to know and respect, but in a sense, he kind of is. So, you know, he's telling Barry, like, he has to do this. And really, at the end of the day, it comes down to Barry's decision. But it's very interesting seeing that those three the most influential males in his life make, you know, it turns into a conversation like that, because, you know, his dad brings up the points like, well, what if this accelerator doesn't work? It could end up killing him, or, you know, because the last time, or, you know, the fact is, even if it did kind of work, when the last time Barry got, when he originally got his powers, he ended up being in a coma for 9 months. And it's like, even if he does get his powers back and he's not in a coma, he still has to go up against Zoom. Like, what's to say Zoom won't kill him, like, break his back like he did previously, or steal his powers again, or just outright kill him, you know? And like I said, Joe's undecided, but, like, Wells is like, Zoom needs to be stopped. The only one that can stop him is Barry. There's no other options available. But like I said, in the day, it was Barry's decision. And it also led to a very interesting conversation between him and Iris. And Iris kind of presented it as like, okay, you know, the fact is that, you know, it's one of these things. It's in the back of my mind. Like, because I've heard someone kind of bring it up before. It's like, the fact is that, oh, Iris is only interested in Barry now because of all this stuff that's happened. Oh, finding out that they're married in the future. Oh, finding out that they're married and together on Earth 2. It's like, to me, Iris has always kind of had feelings for Barry, especially when she found, more specifically when she found out how Barry felt about her. She kind of realized how she felt about him too, but she was dating Eddie at the time and just couldn't bring herself to kind of break away from Eddie to be with Barry. And she kind of, you know, whether those, granted, I'll be blunt, I don't think she had, her feelings, at least at that time, were not nearly as strong for Barry as Barry's feelings for her were, you know. But it's like, you know, now you could be like I said, you could argue like, oh, now that you're both single and just all this time has passed and now you got that information about the future as well as Earth 2, now you want to be with Barry. It's like, no, it's not like she just randomly jumped on this idea this episode. It's something that has been rattling back and forth between in her brain for a while now, you know, because she legitimately hasn't dated anyone since Eddie, you know. It's always been like, that's why she hasn't dated anyone, because she always felt guilty, like, she felt like she was cheating on it. At the same time, too, it's also like, well, because she secretly harbored some feelings for Barry. So it's like, I don't know, it's just kind of interesting that she kind of brought that out. And she was kind of like, I was unavailable at that point in time, but I'm not that way now. She's like, I care for you, Barry. She's like, whether you're the Flash or whether you're just Barry Allen, I care for you. My feelings for you won't change. She's like, I mean, but she's like, this is just how I feel, but it's like, you know, maybe you feel differently, kind of let me know, so. And, to me, one of the badass moments I really liked is when, we ended up having, what was it, a Zoom was basically in front of all those officers, and he kind of, like, slowed everything. Well, obviously, he moved really fast, but it looks like everything was, like, super slowed down, and he went around. to me, it looked like he was just touching them, but, you know, they were all dead. I can only assume he was going, because it looked like it to me, like he went around and just snapped everybody's necks. Was just like, that's a very vicious way to kill someone. Granted, he could, you know, obviously done his typical, you know, the typical speedster thing, phased through him, killed him like that, but nope. He went around and he freaking, like, snapped everybody's necks. Was just like, wow. He did an instant, and then he quickly killed, what was his name, Rupture, who we turned out to be, Cisco's dad's Earth 2 doppelganger, which it never crossed my mind that that was a thing. Because you know why? Because I completely forgot about it. Because his brother doesn't come up that often. His brother's come up in one episode. And that was just kind of like, it never crossed my mind. It's like, oh yeah, what about Cisco's family? Like, he does have a brother. What about his brother on Earth 2? Turns out his brother's a metahuman on Earth 2 as well. And basically, you know, Zoom manipulated him and made him think like, oh yeah, that Vibe killed his brother, Reverb. And it was kind of a little touching, because it's like the whole thing started because Cisco vibed his brother and he went to check on his brother to make sure he's okay. But it's just like they still kind of have that little animosity towards each other. I guess it's just because Cisco always felt like his brother, you know, it's something, you know, Cisco doesn't really bring up too much, but it's just like he always felt inferior to his brother because his brother was the one that got, you know, kind of the attention. He was kind of the special one. And I guess in some way, Cisco's always kind of resented him for it, and, you know, and I guess his brothers kind of always felt that resentment, so they've always stayed apart, and they were kind of under the pressure. He's like, honestly, I don't think we could ever get back, you know, because his brother was like, we've never been tight, we haven't been close since we were kids, because he was saying, like, after everything that went down with Snart and Heatwave last time, you're getting kidnapped, it's like, I thought we would get close after that situation, but, you know, sadly they didn't. And eventually, you know, Cisco did tell him the truth about everything, and he's like, why didn't you tell me? Because it's something you didn't think about, like, I didn't think about it. It's like, Cisco didn't tell anybody that he was going to Earth 2. There's a good chance he wasn't going to be coming back, but he didn't really let anyone know. He didn't let his family know. He didn't let his brother know. But he's like, you were right. Like, why would I tell you? Like, you guys, like, we haven't been that close since we were little kids, and I don't think we'll ever be back that way. But it seems like that relationship is, you know, being remedied, because after seeing Zoom kill Rupture, it ended up kind of sparking something in Cisco's head, which has got to be weird for Cisco. He literally saw Zoom kill him, Reverb, and now he's seen Zoom kill his brother. It's got to be extra weird. But it's like he went and held his brother tight, hugging tight. It's like, man, that's beautiful. I'm glad that they're... It's sad it took, like, seeing his brother being, you know, his brother's doppelganger getting killed for him to be like, you know, to kind of force him to kind of want to mend fences. And then we also had that thing with Caitlyn and Zoom. The fact that Zoom is talking about the reason why he likes Caitlyn so much is because he sees the darkness in her. The darkness is inside him. He kind of sees it in her. And I guess his main reason for seeing that is because he saw the way Killer Frost is. And Killer Frost no, the way he makes it sound, like, it sounds like he's saying, like, he sees the darkness in Caitlyn, just like he sees that darkness within Killer Frost. So it's not just because Killer Frost has darkness in her that he sees it in Caitlyn. It's because he saw it in Caitlyn first, and he sees it also reflected in Killer Frost, which makes me think in my brain, it's like, could this lead to him trying to make her into Killer Frost so he can unleash that darkness inside of her? That's just something that instantly came into my mind. But I was pretty sure Zoom was going to kill Joe's boss. I was so sure he was going. I was like, don't kill him, don't kill him. He's a pretty often recurring character. Don't kill him. He's like, oh, God, thank goodness you didn't kill him. That's awesome. I mean, granted, I mean, that's awesome for him. It sucks for all those other cops who got their necks snapped, but still. But I like that situation because Barry didn't want to get his powers back if it meant sacrificing the lives of other people, because he didn't know what the ramifications of it would be, because there's no telling with something like that, because it's like, even Henry brought it up, it's something that you can't 100% control. It's something that's beyond your control. And, you know, for him to try and recreate what happened to Barry, and it was like, Barry didn't want to take the chance that it would explode and affect a lot of people like it did before. So that was one reason why he didn't do it. But then after seeing everything happen, he was like, I have to. Especially when he found out, because one of the cops that died had a son. And he was like, that son was about the same age that mom, like he was when his mom was murdered. by Reverse Flash. So it's kind of like he's like, because he didn't become, because he didn't get his powers back, he ended that little boy's gonna have to grow up without his father, because you know the Flash wasn't there for him. I mean, and pretty much Zoom has actually told the entire city, it's like the Flash isn't coming to save you. Basically, you know, he's telling them the truth, like, oh, this is a hologram. The Flash, you know, is going. Your last bit of hope is going. This world is mine for the taking. So they ended up setting up the machine. And at this whole time, we had Jesse and Wally kind of locked up in that room, the one that has Gideon in it and all the future-related stuff. That room that Eobard was using when he was Wells. It's very interesting. You kind of see it a little bit in the way they talk, and it's like, I shipped them together so hard. I started shipping them together the first time they met a couple episodes back when they were at that club or whatever. And I was like, wow. And just the way they were talking kind of made a little awkward around each other. I was like... And just them talking now, I was like, okay, legitimately, how I saw this episode playing out, just the moment, once everything was said and done, he was hooked up in the machine, I love the fact that Cisco had to be the one to kind of draw in the bolt of lightning, you know, to strike him. And then legitimately, I thought this was going to happen. Okay, Barry strapped to the machine, he's getting his powers back. Wally and Jesse come out just in time, and the powers like end up accidentally transferring to those two. Barry gets none of the power, and it goes to those two. And then essentially, like, oh, in the next episode, he have to train them so that they can fight Zoom, because there's no way of, like, for some reason they won't be able to replicate what they just did, or it'd be too dangerous to do it. So he has to train and teach Wally and Jesse how to handle this situation. But. It didn't turn out like that. I was not expecting this episode to end the way it did. Essentially have Barry there, like, and you see, like, it hit him. You see all the orange on him. I was like, oh, they're getting close up on him because they're about to show the lightning in his eyes. I was like, oh, man, he's about to get his powers back. I was like, okay, Jesse and Wally come in so he can get powers too. And they just, his skin start peeling. I'm like, wait, what? What? And then he starts screaming. I'm like, what? It took me by surprise. I was not expecting that to happen. And everyone's just looking like, what the hell? And even Zoom shows up because he kind of got a little freaked out. He's like, oh, thank goodness you got rid of, you tried to give him back his speed, but you ended up killing him. Kind of, he's like, good. And you got rid of, like, you know, that way I don't even have to worry about it. Granted, we still saw Wally and Jesse get hit. Granted, they're knocked out, but it's like the Speed Force is in them now, which is pretty awesome. I'll go ahead and say it, because I don't think anyone's going to really care too much. If you don't want to hear about what's happening in the next episode because I saw the preview, then kind of, you know, stop right now. Look in the description and skip ahead to Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. if you want to listen to what, you know, what I thought about this episode. But if you don't care either, then just click away from the video now. So now I'm going to talk about the preview. We end up finding out that Barry isn't dead. He's just, you know, trapped in that freaking world. It looks like kind of like an in-between world wherever he is. That was kind of interesting. I was not expecting that. I was just like, oh my God, did they really just pull like a season 3 of Arrow there just killing off Barry? But it's like, no, he's still alive. I thought it was very interesting because, like, to me, how I'm seeing, because this is apparently... That include, like, there are 3 episodes with that one included. Next week's episode, 3 episodes left this season. To me, how I see this going down, how Barry's going to end up taking down Zoom, is with the help of Jesse and Wanda. Like I said, it's still going to be that concept that I was saying earlier. He's going to have to train them to be faster. And maybe they end up getting help from Jay Garrick because they end up getting him out. And it's just like 4 freaking speedsters against Zoom. It's like no matter how fast he is, even he's going to have trouble going up against multiple speedsters. That's just how I see it going down. I think that'd be so freaking awesome. That's just how I'm theorizing everything. But anyway. But just really wanted to say, really I like this episode. Cannot wait to see where everything goes from here next week. So. Now, moving on to Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., where we have Lincoln kind of doing the kind of typical thing where it's like, oh, I'm so in love, I don't know what to do. It's like, because I guess in his case, like, Daisy kind of brings balance to him. Because it's like, you know, every one of the Inhumans is kind of missing something. They do feel empty on the inside. So to him, it's like Daisy is that thing that kind of brings balance to him, keeps him stable. And he's kind of lost control. We kind of saw that last episode when he was about to fry the lady who can multiply herself. And just because he was trying to track down Daisy. Essentially, he wants to do anything he can do to, like, possibly help. But we have Simmons and Fitz working on trying to find a cure, but they can't find one. There's something to test out, but it would involve them getting a test subject. Lincoln volunteers, but, you know, ultimately, you know, because of what Simmons says, Coulson's kind of like, it's a no-go, but Lincoln injects himself anyway. I did like the fact is when they were about the, you know, because they had to get tissue samples from him, it's like, oh, this is for cut, like, kind of essentially cracking open your skull. She's like, you need to get tissue samples from my, like, my brain. And she's like, yeah, you would know that if you went ahead and asked questions before you went off and just acted recklessly. It's like, he's just hopelessly in love. So sadly, the whole cure thing didn't pan out, which I was kind of hoping for, because it's like, yeah. Because to me, in my brain, it's like, oh, yeah, the power of love. The fact is, Lincoln is willing to do anything, trying to sacrifice himself to make sure that, you know, they get a proper test subject to use to make sure that the cure works. I was kind of actually hoping. I was thinking, oh, yeah, they're going to have a cure. It's like, no. It's actually very interesting. I found that fascinating, because it's like, it was kind of theorized, like, oh, yeah, this is going to be like this whole, like, being under control by Hyde is going to be like a 1 or 2 episode thing. It's like, no, it seems like they have yet to find, this is the 3rd episode, and it's like, they've yet to find, well, it's the 2nd episode. I mean, granted, she got, you know, her mind messed with, like, you know, 3 episodes ago, but this makes, like, the 2nd episode that she's been fully under his control, whatever the case may be. But it's like, I would kind of expecting them to have a cure by now, but it's like, nope. I did like that we ended up finding out a little bit more about Hive's past. We actually got to see what Hive looked like originally. I'm not sure which one it is, whether it's 1,000 years ago or thousands of years ago when we actually see like what Hive originally looked like. Because Hive looked like he was some kind of hunter from a specific tribe when the Creed came and made him into the weapon he is. What he currently is. And it's interesting to see that, because I kind of brought it up last episode. I thought that Hive was trying to in a sense, I was somewhat right. I honestly don't even remember 100% of what I said. I thought, you know, it was going to be like, oh, Hive wanted to make another version of himself using basically Kree technology or whatever, do what the Kree did to him and basically make another him. Well, this was kind of true. He wants to make humans, normal humans, people who don't have that, the potential to become inhumans, you know, kind of have that alien DNA kind of already written into their code, making regular humans into inhumans. That's kind of his plan. And Daisy's kind of okay with it, because, you know, Daisy kind of talks to that dude, James, the dude with fire. Most recent inhuman dude, the Australian guy, he kind of brought up the fact is that, you know, because her Daisy, because of S.H.I.E.L.D. and Hive being on different sides, eventually Hive is going to go after them and wipe them out. And then Daisy's like, no, she doesn't have to do that. They're just confused. They don't see what we see because, you know, given an opportunity, they will. But he's like, I don't think it's going to end very well for them. But Daisy kind of gets in her mind, like, if they can expedite this whole experiment, they can end up turning everyone in S.H.I.E.L.D. into inhumans. And then they can finally be a part of, you know, the quote unquote Hive mind and kind of see what she sees and feels what she feels. I thought it was very interesting. We got those original, I guess they were like 3 heads of Hydra, like some of the few heads of Hydra that are still left. And they ended up trying to make them inhumans, and their skin boiled and melted. Well, not boiled, but just liquefied. And it was just like disgusting. And I love how that Dr. Doom was like, yeah, Hydra brings it up. Oh, so you're saying it's my fault? He's like, no, I'm not. Okay, yes, it's your fault. Because essentially, because the body he's in, the blood they use from his body isn't that of a Kree. It's essentially Ward's blood. So it's the blood of the dead guy he's possessing. So that's why that's why things didn't work out the way they wanted them to. Very interesting to me, like, that doctor was one of the funniest things about this episode. I just liked his reaction and the things he said. He was just kind of, I feel like they kind of let his personality slip out a little more this episode. I feel like we didn't really get to see a lot of him last episode, just at nearing the end. But now we're kind of getting to see his personality come out a little bit. And he's actually a pretty funny dude. Like I said, I love that actor who plays, I didn't catch his name this week either. But like I said, he's from the Mummy movies. He's like a funny actor. He's really good. I haven't seen him in too many things, but, you know, I've seen him in some stuff. There's like a short British series that he was a part of. I forgot. A Touch of Cloth. Is that what it was? It's kind of like a parody of like police procedurals. Nevertheless, moving on. But I really liked it when they went up against the Kree. I really liked when well, sadly, we have multiplying girl who multiplies herself. She got taken down pretty easily, and apparently, she's not coming back ever again. We won't ever be seeing her again. Sadly, she's dead. I was just like, okay, like he was picking up his weapon and about to bring it down. I'm like, okay, someone's going to jump in, and it's like, nope, she's dead. I did like the fact is when Daisy went up against one of them, because granted, she was kind of like hesitant about being able to take one of them down, because apparently they're called Reapers. They're kind of like more deadlier than your typical Kree. And I like the fact is when she fought him and she actually beat him down. I thought that was kind of interesting. First with his arm and then both of his legs. And then she did it one more time on his back. And the guy was like, what was that sound? She was like, she drained his spine. I was like, ooh, Daisy. It's like, to me, is it me or has Daisy gotten even more badass, like, since being under Hive's control? I guess, for one, this is, like, one of the first times she's ever been able to go all out against an opponent. Because it's, like, with a Kree, she has to, because it's kill or be killed, right? Because I guess because Daisy's never really had a situation where she's needed to go all out like that. But it's just, I don't know, I feel like she kicks more ass under Hive's control than she did before. But like I said, you know, maybe she's just thinking like, oh, I need to get this job done, like, for Hive. So maybe those pleasure sensors are pushing her to go even more badass or something. I don't know. And you had that moment which kind of like broke my heart. It's like you see Mac there trying to talk her down. It's like, this isn't you. This is that thing messing with your head. She's like, no, this is really me. She's essentially saying like, oh, S.H.I.E.L.D. is trying to use me. They turned you. You were a mechanic. I was a hacker. And they turned us into like, what, soldiers. Which, now that I'm thinking about it, I forgot the fact is that freaking Hive made a reference to the Civil War movie, the Captain America Civil War movie that's coming up. Because he was like, oh yeah, you have like a millionaire, billionaire, with a mechanical suit, making an armored suit. Then you have, like, you know, super soldiers. It's like, but they're going to be kind of caught up in a war, which is going to lead to a war of its own. So it's like, I just love that little, it wasn't even subtle. It was like a blatant slap in your face, like, psh, yeah, Civil War's coming up. Remember that. It's really sad because it's like they never really, like, the shows mention the movies because typically, like, you know, what happens in the cinematic movies have heavy effects on the TV shows. Typically, you know, sometimes they only have like one episode things, because there was like one episode in season one that was kind of the aftermath of the second Thor movie. So stuff like that. But it's like, it's something that's constantly come back and forth. It's like, will the like movies ever reference the TV show? Because it's like, let's not forget, like, Thor still doesn't know that Coulson's alive because they haven't brought that connection together. Because they just haven't. Like, and apparently, you know, there's kind of a split between TV Marvel as well as cinematic Marvel, just between the, like, the top heads about it, just people different opinions about how things should be done, and just people have been allocated to just, you know, people who are, you know, part of the movie projects as well have just been allocated to just doing a TV series. So it's just kind of like, will that ever happen? I don't know. I want it to happen. I want there to be crossover. I want to see some Inhumans in the Marvel movies and just, you know, just see them reference stuff. I want to see Coulson in some more movies. Like, someone was, I don't know, it's just this something I was just kind of having a bit of a tangent about, sorry. But it was really sad, you know, she even threw the back fact that she's like, you are like a brother, big brother to me, almost. I mean, more so than, but, you know, let's face it, you weren't even a big brother to the brother you already have, so let alone you being a brother to me. And it's just like, wow, Daisy, that was a low blow. And then she was like, she knocked him out of the, like, garage or whatever, well, the little place they were at, and was got on top and started beating the crap out of him, like, using her powers to, like, hold his arms up. It's just, like, punching him repeatedly in the face. I was like, holy crap. And then she touched his chest, and she was about to do her whole thing. Luckily, May came up and shot her, but it's just like, man, she was legitimately about to kill Mac. She was like, she was sorry because she wanted Mac to, you know, because she cares for Mac, because Mac was kind of always kind of had her back, and, you know, she wanted him to experience it. She wanted them to kind of keep their connection and stay together throughout this whole situation. But she's like, it's impossible now. And Hive kind of is disappointed in her because she's like, you let Mac get away. They ended up, because Mac ended up disintegrating the Kree's body, so it's kind of useless. Hive ended up going up against one of the Kree, which I'm surprised, like, that kind of ended the way it did. It just ended with, you know, Hive killing it and, you know, ripping its heart out. And it's just like, I was kind of expecting there to be a little bit more trouble because he made it seem like, oh yeah, the Kree are like what I fear most. I mean, he brought them there. I mean, that's what that whole technology was, because he said it was the only way of stopping him. So I'm guessing the Kree were the only way of stopping him. But it's like they did a piss poor job at that. They couldn't even stop you. It's like I was expecting them to do something to slow you down, but it's like no. It was more so than anything, it was him just facing his fear and just being like, now that they're dealt with, he has nothing to fear, I guess. Because we've seen weapons kind of don't do nothing to him. Like, was that a rocket launcher she shot at him or something? It literally blew off his shoulder and he just regenerated it. So it's just like, how the hell do you stop something that just keeps coming back for you more and more like that? Which kind of gets me thinking about Fitz and Simmons, how like they kind of made comparisons. Because Fitz was talking about how the fact is Daisy was trying to be all buddy buddy with him, while at the same time she was killing him. But then Simmons is like, oh, you think you had it rough? Let's not forget that I came in contact with Hive, and Hive was just kind of like, oh, hey, here I am using the memories of Will, your dead boyfriend, to kind of mess with you. He's kind of like, yeah, you kind of had it rougher than you. She's like, yeah, so. I also like the fact is that May was kind of flirting with that guy James, the Australian dude. I did like that she was kind of, pretending to be like part of Hydra and just being like, oh, milking him for information. It's so weird when you see May like that, when you kind of see that like different side of May, because we're always kind of seeing the more serious and stoic May. But when you see her kind of laughing and smiling and being almost a completely different person, it throws you for a loop and you're just kind of like, what is going on? Is that the same person? And it's like, yeah, that is. But at the very end of the episode, we had Daisy kind of turning herself over. She's like, okay, if he needs Kree blood, the best option is for Daisy, because, Coulson had her injected with it so that he could save her life. So he's like, essentially, she's like, drain me dry, because she believes in the cause so much. She's like, bleed me dry and use my blood to, expedite this whole situation so we can turn more regular people into inhumans. So it's kind of like, kind of a race against time to make sure that we're able to like stop the plan, but all at the same time, like, save Daisy, whether they actually can save Daisy or not, because the whole cure with Lincoln didn't work, sadly. And it was kind of Lincoln's last hope, and it was kind of their last hope too, because Mac was so hoping that Daisy was still herself, that because he was like, oh yeah, like she let herself be caught on camera, and he's like, she wants, subconsciously wanted to be caught. There was some part of her still there that wanted to be caught. But Coulson's kind of like, no, Daisy created this whole like system. If she wanted, to avoid the camera, she would know how to. The fact that she got caught was a trap. It wasn't necessarily that, the way she thought, she explained it, which I thought was very interesting. She's like, I'm not going to hide anymore. Like that, I would have avoided it if I was still thinking like a SHIELD agent. I'm not a SHIELD agent anymore. I'm just me. So I'm not going to bother trying to like be stealthy and hide. Like I don't have anything to hide. So I thought that was kind of interesting. Coulson didn't want to be right about it, but sadly he was. So it's like, what are they going to do? There's no cure. There's no clear way of killing Hive. So I was like, what can they do? Especially when this jerk is about to try and turn all of humanity into. In humans, more people for him to control, making an army of his. And I saw the preview of the next episode, which I'm not going to talk about necessarily that it goes out. Just one fact is that apparently next episode is when we find out who specifically is the character that died. I'm totally freaking forgetting. Next week is actually the season finale. It's a 2-hour season finale, and I love it. I love 2-hour season finales because I hate having to wait. Because you can obviously tell it's just like put it together. I love 2-hour season finales. It's just, oh, I can't believe I almost let that slip my mind that that is it. So it's just like, we are going to find out who it is. It's in that space shuttle or whatever, that Daisy saw, that we saw at the beginning of the second half of the season, and Daisy saw in her vision. So it's like, we'll find out who it is. And it's just like, one of these characters is going to drop dead, and I have no idea who it's going to be. To me, first one that's kind of coming to mind is Mac. I don't know if that's true or not. Like, to me, that whole situation could have been like them setting up Mac, introducing his brother, just so that we get used to his face to be like, oh yeah, Mac's brother is now taking his spot. Possibly. I don't know. Because it's like, because now that, I don't know. I'm only going to speculate him. The first person that was honestly come to my mind was like Daisy, that it could have been her. I think I talked about that before, but it's just like, I don't know. Like I said, you would think, because she's such a specific character, so because she holds that main character status, you'd kind of think they wouldn't do that. But it's like, honestly, you never know with this. But like I said, my money's on Mac, not necessarily for it. Well, there is one particular reason, because you see Yo-Yo's Cross up there, so it makes me think, you know, out of anyone on the team, she'd obviously, I forgot, she did give it to Mac, didn't she? Or is that just, or did she not? I don't remember. If she hasn't given it to Mac already, she probably will at some point, so it's kind of like, I don't know. But, like I said, we won't find out till next week, and it's just like, I have no idea how any of this is going to be set or how any of this is going to end. Which, at the same time, we see James in the pre... No. But that's really all I want to talk about in this episode. Till the next time we meet, be happy, be safe, live life to the fullest, and enjoy it. Good day, and goodbye.